Come on, let's give the Lord a better hand clap than that. He deserves all glory in the house. Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. I praise you, Jesus. Lord, without you, I am nothing, Jesus. I can't even breathe without you in my life, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I am definitely stirred this morning. Brother, everything Brother Leroy said, I give it a loud amen to that. There's something that's moving not only in the house but in this world right now. We can get caught up on what it looks like on TV, or we can get caught up on what it says in the Bible, and we can go ahead and believe and watch things happen through faith. Amen? I'm gonna read my scriptures first, I promise. I'm going to do the best I can with what God has given me today. Hallelujah. If you want to stand for the reading of the word, if that's your custom. Hallelujah, Jesus. Ooh, hallelujah. Boy, ain't God good. Ain't God good. Ain't God good. Ain't God good. I love the fact that we have a word. Many of people are lost in this time and age. Many of people have no grounding. Many people have a path that they've chosen, but yet they don't have substance to back it up. There's no foundation to what they believe. Aren't you glad that there is a word of God? Aren't you glad that in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God? Aren't we glad that we have a God that has a word that we can pull up anytime? Even when you may not be able to feel it, you can read exactly what God is. And I want to thank God for the word today, and that I've just stirred in my spirit. Hallelujah. The word is more important now to you, I promise you, in this day and age than it ever has been. Don't wait on Sunday morning to get what words you get during the week. You need to get that word as much as you can. Let it be hidden in your heart today. Luke chapter 16. I'm going to read to you in the New Living Translation. 16 and 29 says, "But Abraham said, Moses and the prophets have warned them. Your brothers can read what they wrote. The rich man replied, No, Father Abraham, but if someone is sent to them from the dead," talking about Lazarus, "if then they will repent of their sins and turn to God. But Abraham said, if they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, if they won't listen to what they read, they won't be persuaded, even if someone rises from the dead." Matthew chapter 27 and 20 says, "But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus." I don't know about you, but there's a lot of screams these days for Barabbas. They want to destroy the Jesus that you have. Luke chapter 20 and 6. And if we say of men," these are the Pharisees when Jesus, they try to attack Jesus with their religious beliefs and doctrine, and Jesus threw it back in their face and said, tell us if John's baptism was from God, from heaven, or was it from man? And they reason with themselves and they say, "But if we say of men, all the people will stone us, for they be persuaded that John was a prophet." Romans chapter 4, 20 and 20 through 22 in the New Living. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this he brought glory to God. He was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. And because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. Romans chapter 8. 38 through 39, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen? Amen. Last set of scriptures, Acts 21, verse 13 says, "Then Paul answered, What mean ye to weep and to break mine heart? For I am ready not to be bound only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. And when he would not be persuaded, we ceased, saying, The will of the Lord be done." Heavenly Father, right now, Lord, I ask you to anoint our hearts, anoint our minds, Lord Jesus. Lord, help me to be as transparent as I can be today, Lord. Lord Jesus, whatever it is that you've imparted into me, Lord, help me to give it the way that you gave it to me, Jesus. I ask you right now to have your way in this place. Lord, let your power be shown, Lord. Let your word be sung. Lord, right now, in Jesus' name, I ask you to touch each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Well, I feel it. I feel it. You know, I know I'm a big proponent on not working off of feelings. I'm big on we always say those words, and I know what we really mean. Because if you've ever been touched by God, you know, we talk. It's what we do. We preach, and everything we preach is right here. You're not going to get a message from me from Emmanuel. Now we read books, and we get great other men who have touched God, and God has touched them and used them. We use their books, and we look at their books. But their books are not this book. Their book is not the Bible. That means that whatever they say, if it doesn't line up to this, then we just kind of let it slip on by. Or we don't. And we latch on to what the Bible talks about, any old doctrine or just any old wind that'll blow through this world. So for the next few minutes, hopefully the Holy Ghost will allow me to speak to you on the power of persuasion. The power of persuasion. In my reading, I read to you about how Abraham was persuaded that he was, it's a champion of faith. It's in the chapter of faith and the champion of faith, and it talks about that Abraham was so persuaded that God was going to do what he said he was going to do. So persuaded. This is what my hope is today, for not just myself, but for each and every one of us, that we'll get a persuasion that'll bring righteousness unto us. I was talking to Brother Don this morning. We were talking about that, and how the Bible says that your righteousness, what we come with, is like filthy rags.
Right, right.
And then there's other things that we don't. And then we start talking about how the only righteousness that we even have, the only thing that we even have that's any good in our life, comes through faith in Jesus Christ. It comes from being in Jesus Christ.
Right.
And then I just found that this morning I was reading, and it said that God counted Abraham as righteous because he was persuaded that what God said he was going to do.
That's right.
And I started to feel unrighteous for a moment. I started to think about it. I said, well, God, I'm persuaded. I feel like that it's going to be what you said it's going to be, whatever. And then all of a sudden, I didn't feel as righteous as maybe I thought I should have been. And God spoke it into my spirit. He said, David, if you believe that what I said I was going to do, I'm going to do, then you carry that promise up onto the mountain and you lay that promise on the altar. Oh, we miss out on that story many a times, knowing good and well that everything that God has promised us that was good. Now, we don't like them promises that is bad. We don't like none of that. We don't want none of that to do with any of that stuff. But if it's in here, then it's in here. We cannot start trimming this thing down, because if you chink in one armor, if you tear out one page, then what is else left? On the job site, whenever when I get a package, I'm working a project right now, and then if you read the ISOs and you look down at the bottom, it'll tell you the paint spec. It'll tell you the hydro pressure, which means how we test it to see if it'll hold pressure. It'll tell you the running pressure, the running temperature, all these different things. But then at the very bottom in the left-hand corner, normally it'll say 5% shop, 10% field. And this is the procedure for us on how we check the welds on every pipe job. Now, I know some of y'all looking at me like, y'all ain't never heard this stuff before. I'm breaking the pipe fitter code right now. Some of y'all maybe never heard of that, But when they shoot X-ray, they check the metallurgy, they check to see if the weld's any good.
Right.
And that means that in the shop, when they built the pipe, the few spools that they do out there, that they only shot 5%. And then the things that we do in the field, they're going to shoot 10%. That means if we weld 100 welds, they're going to shoot 10 of them. All right? That's how math works, just in case y'all was wondering how to do your tithe on 10%. All right? You got 100, you got to pay $10. All right? So, but the policy also is that if they shoot 10% on any welder and they find one bad, then they shoot another 10% of that.
Right.
And so on and so forth. And then there are other jobs where if you shoot any and they are bad on anything, they shoot socket welds and certain procedures, and when they shoot them, if they find one bad, they shoot them all.
Right.
If you cannot take this in its entirety, if you're not persuaded of it and of its entirety, that means that his stripes that you claim for your healing are the same thing where it talks about thou shalt not lie. And if you tear out the one about lying, then you might as well go ahead and tear out the one about getting your healing.
All right, good.
If you're not persuaded.
All right.
Abraham was counted as righteous, but I like how whenever I read you the scripture, I know it seemed to be obscure. I took it out of two different stories, but whenever the church at that time had brought up Jesus and Barabbas, and we love that part, and we talk about how the Easter drama, you know, and we did here, and I was Barabbas. I had a good time playing the bad guy. It was fun. But you know, and they holler out, Barabbas, Barabbas, Barabbas. But it said it plain and clear. I don't even remember it saying it, but it said it right then. It said the priests, the church leaders, that they persuaded the people. They persuaded the people to call out for Barabbas and to destroy Jesus. Now we always hear it all the time that they were screaming. Now we thought the people were on their own, and all of a sudden I always wonder how in the world could Jesus be your buddy one day healing and walking on water and giving you all food whenever there was nothing there but a couple of loaves and a couple of fishes and you know this stuff, and how can you be? Because there's somebody out there that persuaded them to destroy Jesus.
Right.
You know what that tells me? That tells me people are fickle. That tells me that people were not persuaded about Jesus. They were persuaded about the things they got from Jesus. And if you're not persuaded about Jesus, that anybody can come along, any church leader, any little ministry, any little thing that come along and call themselves a church or a religion can come along and they can tell you what you should or should not believe about what this says about Jesus. And if you're not careful, that in a moment when you should be crying out to Jesus, all you'll ask for is Barabbas.
Right.
In the same effect, you don't understand how the power of persuasion can move people. How they move people to call out for Jesus. Now we let them do that. We call it good, it's okay, because without them calling out for Barabbas, we don't get Jesus on the cross. That's what we think. That's what we feel. It's predestined. Jesus Christ was going to already go to the cross, going to save our sins by being up there. So we'll buy that. But what I love about the power of persuasion is that when Jesus asked them Pharisees, them religious leaders, and he asked them about John's baptism of repentance, when we start to lay the groundwork of what he says, that they were careful. I'm going to tell you how you get religious folks who call themselves religious. I'm going to tell you how you get them on their heels. How they'll be real careful to answer you is when you start asking whether or not it's in here.
Right.
Whether or not it's in here. Chapter and verse. That's what we want. When we really get into it, we'll be like, hey, I understand what you're saying, but let me go up here. Where is it at, chapter and verse? Can you tell me where it's at, chapter and verse? And what he said was, he said, is it from heaven? Remember when we said God, right? The word God. Is it from heaven, right here? Or is it from men? And all of a sudden, any religious leader worth his salt will start to backtrack and to backpedal. And they'll talk amongst themselves. Well, if we say it's from men, then the people here, they were persuaded that John was from God. He was a prophet. And whenever you can get people persuaded, let me tell you something right now. The reason why you should hang out with people iron sharpeneth iron, the reason why you ought to hang out with people who are persuaded about Jesus Christ and him crucified, is because in any given moment, whenever somebody's bringing up you, when they're trying to trip you up, you'll have some people who are persuaded about, and that the world and those religious leaders at the time won't be able to put their hands on you. Listen to me. They could not, for fear of being stoned, because of John the Baptist was seen as a prophet. How great is the power of persuasion, to the point where if we just get in line with this. The reason I'm carrying this around is because it's been on my heart real hard the last 2 or 3 days. I have watched, and I won't go into it a lot, but I have watched religious leaders. I get on TikTok like some of y'all, and I watch all these little videos, and I've seen some very disturbing things this past week where they have taken and they've twisted my God. And they've said things that are, and I've heard people say that if you follow Jesus, you follow Jesus, but don't follow Paul. You heard what I said? The same Bible that brings you Jesus, the words of Jesus, the same Bible, the same Jesus that Paul says that he will do any. I read it to you here, that not only was he willing to go to Jerusalem, but he was willing to die for the name of Jesus. He was willing to die for the name of Jesus. That same Paul, they're saying, don't listen to him because he said things that offend the culture today. Listen to me. All right, I'm not going to get political and I'm not going to bash the culture as much as I feel like I ought to. If you know me, you know me. But at the same time is that if it's in here and it hurts you, I promise you, there's hope in here. Jesus said that he would not allow you to be tempted more than you could bear. But what he really was saying is that you'll be tempted to the point where you have to turn to me. And when you turn to me, that I will give you a way of escape. That means that if it talks about, I'm trying to not to pick some things. I mean, if you're dealing with them, God is just trying to talk to you today and you'll just be okay. Everybody online, you have to read your Bible and go find it, all right? I'm going to try to stick to lying because everybody hates a liar, right? Right? How about thieves? Everybody hates a thief. Well, you shouldn't hate nobody, but everybody don't like a thief, you know? Well, we'd be down on the thieves. It's in here. It's in here, all right? And if I preach about stealing, if I preach about thievery, and I come against thievery because it's one of the Ten Commandments, it's one of the stone built, you know what I'm saying, written in stone. I'm not talking about just something about eating food of idols. That's in here too. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about something that was in the beginning set forth. Don't steal. Don't lie. The Bible says that all liars will have their place in the lake of fire. It's also listed with fornicators, murderers, adulterers. Oh, Lord, we're starting to get around our neighborhood now or the culture. Let's go back to lying. How about that? We all don't like no liars. But if it's in here, you got to be persuaded enough that what God has said, that he is not only able and faithful and willing to do, and that can't just be for your healing and your salvation. Amen. If he says that all liars have their place in the lake of fire, that means that if you're a liar, the Bible says that one day, whenever it is that you pass on, or when this world comes to an end, that you will have your own spot. Row D, seat 32, your spot in the lake of fire. And if that hurts your feelings because you're a liar, I'm sorry. But this is not to hurt your feelings. What it is supposed to unroot you from the place that you've allowed yourself to sink into. And now there is a way of escape. You say, well, how do I stop lying, brother? I'm going to tell you right now that the Bible says that he is the truth, the way, and the life. That means if we get Jesus on the inside of us, that if we are in him, we are new creatures. That means that in that moment when you lean on Jesus, the minute you go to try to say something that ain't true, that all of a sudden the Spirit of God will quicken into your heart. And he'll say, no, let's just go ahead and stand on the truth. I got your back. It don't matter if it hurts. It doesn't matter if it hurts. I will back you up. I will bring you out. And all of a sudden, now there's peace. Ooh, Lord, the Lord is running through me on all kinds of issues. I might want to put that Bible down. I might say something that might hurt somebody's feelings. The problem is that we'll there are things in this world that we like. There's things in this world that we like. They make us feel a type of way. All right? I'll talk about drugs and alcohol because I used to do drugs and alcohol. You know what I really love, though? I really love how y'all okay with that. Y'all okay with my testimony. You know why? Most of y'all didn't know me because it didn't bother you at all. So you don't have a past with me in my sin. Oh, I'm about to dig just a little bit. It'd be all right. You don't have a past with me in my drug abuse. My son does, but you don't. I never stole from you. I never done you wrong. You never seen me that kind of way. All you see is my testimony. You've seen some of the pictures, but you've seen my testimony. And because of that, you're okay with it. All right? So I can talk about it. I got free range to talk about it. Right. Oh, in the recovery world, they don't like, don't talk about it if you ain't never been through it. I hear you. That's fine. But it's in here. It's in here. It says not to be drunk with excess. All right? Does it say don't drink? It don't say don't drink. But I can tell you something right now. Whatever you latch on to, that will latch on to you. And if you ever struggled and had a problem, I don't care how much Jesus and how many times you spoke in tongues, don't you ever touch it again. Now, that may hurt your feelings a little bit if that's a problem you have in the house. And I'm sorry, but I can tell you right now that the Bible said, he said it earlier, that Jesus came to set the captives free. That means if you've ever been captivated by any old thing, pornography, drugs, alcohol, lying, promiscuity, adultery, huh? All of those, fornication, all of those things, that if you have a problem, that he said he came to set the captives free. So if it tells you that you're wrong, Jesus says, I'm willing to make you right. And if you're persuaded about what the Bible says that it is, if you'll go ahead and pick this thing up and say, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and get persuaded about exactly what God says.
All right. That's good.
I come against false doctrine and all that. I know that might be a problem. For me, it may be all right. I come against that where we twist and turn and we pull out what we don't want to make ourselves feel better. It's not about your feelings. I promise you right now, if you're one of them liars, when you go to get set on fire for eternity, it's going to be a bad feeling. What's a lie worth to you? What's this worth? What's a relationship you're not supposed to have worth to you? What in the long run? The Bible says that we should not store up things for right now. It even talks about not working out, but if you work out, it's okay. But it talks about not doing things that are for now, because if you're not careful, you're going to live somewhere for eternity. I've said it before, there's only two places. Right? There ain't no ghetto in heaven. I done said it before. I'm telling you right now, you're not going to lesser heaven or lesser hell. There's two places. There's gnashing of teeth. There's praising God for eternity. Man, that's a tough choice. But is it? It is. When we wrap ourselves up and we're not persuaded about what the God of heaven said, not only in his book. We're persuaded about Jesus coming to save us, and we love that part. We love John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. We love that part, that whosoever will believe on him, that they're going to be saved. We love that part, but we don't want to do anything else with that, and we don't want to talk about that stuff we're talking about over there in Corinthians and all that. We don't want to talk about what Paul said, serving in Jesus Christ. We don't want the whole Bible. We want half the Bible. And we don't even want half the Bible. We won't throw all that Old Testament out for sure. We don't want none of that. We don't want none of that God of judgment. We don't want none of them rules and all them regulations and all that. We don't want none of those at all. You know why we have the Old Testament in the first place? To show us what it was, and then now we can understand what it has become. Whenever Jesus came, he said he did not come to tear down the law. He came to fulfill the law. It was a system that was not even for us. I heard something this morning that not only blew my mind, I've heard it many a time before, but he said, you know, we get all excited about that there, Acts 2:38, but that wasn't even for us. That was for the Jews. Had nothing to do with you. You Gentiles. Ain't no Jews in here. Not that I know of. Look, I know all of y'all. You were Gentiles. The day of Pentecost wasn't even for you. It was for the chosen people. You got to skip on down there when Cornelius, and all of a sudden he's in prayer. And God wants to fulfill a new covenant with somebody that wasn't even supposed. You know, we get excited about being grafted into the vine. There is a vine, and there is a chosen people. But all of a sudden, God said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm about to bust this thing wide open. I'm about to make sure that everybody, that everyone on the whole earth is going to be able to reap my promises. That by his stripes ye were healed stuff. You got to read your Bible if you're going to understand it as the whole truth now. And all of a sudden now here we are. And if you're not persuaded, the fact that Cornelius all of a sudden was in prayer. And then he sent people, said send people down there to see Peter. Peter's going to come down there. And in that moment there was truth and there was that. And he was persuaded. What if he would not have been persuaded? I'm going to try to hurry up and finish. God's about to do something in here. If it pricks your heart, root it out. Right. Root it out. It's not a Sunday morning message. It's supposed to be about faith. We ain't living the dream series. I'm trying to tell you, I'm trying to help you on how to live the dream in the first place. The reason why a lot of us relive the same nightmares is because we're not persuaded that Jesus is going to do what he said he's going to do.
That's what it comes down to. You're not persuaded. You're persuaded about some of them scriptures. But if you're not persuaded about God, God, right here, all the way, front to back, God, if you believe John, we love John. John, the book of love, the prophet of love, we love John. All right, you love John? Everybody loves John. Yeah, I like all them verses. John got all them, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and the gospel. John was doing a lot. Hey, Revelation, he was in the Lord. Oh, we love John. If you're going to listen to John, where John clearly tells you that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made God, all right? If you skip on down and then he tells you that the Word was made flesh, that's Jesus, and he walked among us, that means that whatever Jesus said is the Word, and whatever the Word is, God ordained. And if God ordained your healing, then he ordained you to lay down fornication. And how are we going to do that? We got to be persuaded that the thing that points it out to us is also the thing that's going to bring us across the river. You understand that they were not persuaded. They sent all them spies and 10 back, came back with an evil report. But two were persuaded. And it took them a little while longer and a bunch of ground opening up and a bunch of people dying. But then one day, people who had not seen the things that happened in Egypt, kids, had grown up. They had got to a point, but they persuaded them and said that we can go over there and we can take the promised land. And all of a sudden, in one moment, people who had no past, listen to me, new converts, people who don't quite think you know the Bible like you want to know the Bible, in one moment being persuaded about a promise will allow you to pick up your family and those that you love and cross over into something that you ain't never even seen before. And there's milk and honey, and there's a little bit of work that's got to be done. But you know what? You're persuaded that, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and that he is my God. And if he's my God and I am his child, that means that when I get over on the other side, it don't matter if they're giants or midgets. It don't matter if it's plagues or famine. It doesn't matter if it's walled cities of Jericho. Something is about to happen. Because I am persuaded, and not only will any of these things separate me from God, but I am persuaded that what he says is true.
That's good right there.
And if what he says is true, then you got to understand that God has you right where he wants you. And if you'll just wake up and listen to him, that he wants to fulfill every dream and every promise, not only in this word, but those he has spoken into your spirit. And if you're persuaded about it, just like he said earlier, you'll get up and you'll go do something about it. Oh, we don't like that part. We want microwave Jesus. We like that microwave Jesus. We like to be able to hit the 30 seconds, pow, pow, pow. Get it. Unfortunately, Jesus is not a bag of popcorn. I know that's what we want. We show in our hearts and our actions our level of persuasion when it comes down to faith, not only in his word, but obedience to his word, our giving, and our praise and worship. That's just the hard truth. This is where we show our persuasion. You know how you can tell an old saint of God that has been through some stuff? Because it doesn't matter what's going on in their lives, that they'll get up front and they'll lift their hands and they keep praising, because they are persuaded that nothing can separate them from the love of God. And that just like the Bible said, that if a good father would get his child a bread and not a stone, then how about your heavenly father? What would he give you? That means I am persuaded that if he is my father and I am in the lineage of Jesus because I am grafted into the vine, that means I'm persuaded that it doesn't matter if I get punched in the nose tomorrow, knocked down, lose my job, and everything goes haywire, that I know that God is going to take care of me. He is going to lift me up out of my situation. That means I can't just sit there in the dust and wait for it. I get up. I go back to the altar. I say, you know what, God? I've fallen off, but I need you to help me. I need you to lift me up. And then he forgives me. And when he forgives me, he pushes me further, farther, faster. Everybody love my testimony, because you didn't see it. I mean, you love it because you can identify with it, too. I'm not saying it's the only reason, but when I came here, I was skinny. I was all cracked out looking. All right. Y'all love that. Hallelujah, he's fat now. Whoa. Yeah, y'all love that. Y'all love that. He gained weight. Oh, yeah, he's living life happy. All right. When I came here, I was not married to my beautiful wife now, and I didn't see my kid and all that, and I saw, that pulls on your heartstrings, you know, especially if you ain't never had your family or you don't have your kid and all that. And I got a testimony where God restored it. Now, that's awesome. That's great. You love that because you didn't have to live it with me. But there was a time here where I was a sinner by the word of God. And y'all don't want to talk about it because y'all love me. But I'm good with that. You ain't got to talk about it. You got plenty of people talking about me. You ain't got to add to it. It'll be all right. But there was a time where my testimony shifted. And I wasn't living like I was supposed to be living. But something happened to me in the first testimony where I was persuaded about God and his word. And even though this book hurt my feelings, listen to me, I was studying it this morning and it jumped out on the page again. And I went ahead and recommitted myself to God and understood that not only has he forgiven me, but he has put his blood upon me and he has put his anointing upon me. And I didn't fall into that trap like Elijah where I felt like I was alone and I prayed for my death. No. I reminded not only the enemy, but I reminded this old flesh that his hand is upon me, that he has anointed me to preach the gospel. And because of that, I will say exactly what I say. That this Bible right here rooted something in me and it hurt me because I was living like I wasn't supposed to, coming to the house of God. You better listen. Living in sin, trying to be a part of the family. All right? Oh, it's good now because I'm preaching. Hallelujah. But at the time, people wanted me gone. Listen to me. We'll call it how it is. People did not like the fact that I was sinning, and they didn't see a physical chastisement on me. I'm going to help you out real quick, all right? But I was persuaded that I would not let go. I would not leave. Listen to me. Everybody's going to be faced with the same thing. If you have fallen, please do not stay fallen because you feel like people are going to judge you harshly. I'm going to tell you right now, they judged me anyway. And it didn't matter if it was harshly, but they did it behind my back. And some of them would love me enough to do it to my face. But because they judged me, I did not quit. And I did not quit because I was persuaded that the things that God had already said, that he was willing to bring me out. And even though I was hurt and I was wrong, listen to me, I'm not making no excuses. You ain't gonna hear none from me. I was wrong, and when I was wrong, I was in sin, and when I was in sin, I hurt for it. But God. See, whenever God pointed out my stuff to me, he said, you know what, though? I can turn it all around. It wasn't for my chastisement. It wasn't for me to be thrown down. It wasn't for you. I'm telling you right now, I was the wrong one. If you'd have tried to drag me down here and try to pull all my sins, I know churches that do that. If you'd have tried to pull all my sins down, we'd have had it out right here. I promise you. If you don't know me well enough, you'd have known it had went down. Like, all right? It had been on like Donkey Kong. All right? That is exactly what had happened. We'd have been moving some furniture in up in here. This is why I'm not so easy and so eager to pull out your sin and cast it down here. That's why these days I'm a little more compassionate than I used to be, because I understand that this thing will point you out. If you're not careful, it'll point you out and it'll tell you about yourself. But at the same time, if you're not paying attention, you won't be persuaded that when he points it out, boy, there's a way of escape coming. And all of a sudden, things start to lie. And when you line up with the word of God, now, it ain't conventional. It ain't cookie cutter. Sin is ugly. Sin will always tear at you in the wrong kind of way. People will lose faith in you. They'll look down on you, and they will chastise you because they don't know Jesus. Because Jesus told that woman, he says, where are your accusers, woman? And she said, I don't see him anymore. He said, neither do I accuse you. If you're willing to stay committed, if you're willing to be persuaded that you're at the feet of the right one, if you're persuaded that if you're in the right presence, if you'll get you. See, the problem is a lot of us, we remove ourselves from God's presence. We remove ourselves from Jesus' people because we feel like we don't deserve it. You're right, you don't. But yet there is a place for you. And if you get persuaded that no matter what, come hell or high water, I'm going to get it right. No matter what, I'm going to get there. I am persuaded. And the power of your persuasion will move you past
your inability to do the things you feel like are right. And God will start to strengthen you. And he strengthened me, and he strengthened my hands, and he strengthened everything about me. And then all of a sudden, one day, and right here, standing right here, something happened. And all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost started to move. And whenever I made a commitment and I started moving forward, all of a sudden, God turned the world for me. I don't know if you get it, but I was persuaded that he would, and he did. And I don't care what anybody has to say about it, because in one moment, God's forgiveness washed over me and the blood applied, and all of a sudden I was somebody new, and I didn't expect it and I didn't understand it because it was something outside of my realm. All I knew was is that God had me, and because he had me, all of a sudden it worked out. Listen to me today. I'm trying to hurry up and close. I didn't even get to the point about Paul. And Paul is told a prophetic word by Agabus. Agabus tells him, whoever this girdle belongs to, they're gonna bind him up. The church people are gonna bind him up. They're gonna throw him. Listen to me, I understand. I've been church hurt. I know how it feels. People may be sitting in here right now, you feel like don't like you. You'll be all right. Get over it. Jesus loves you. That's what got me through. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. I promise you. I promise you this. He'll reach into places that they can't. He'll reach into place. He'll touch places that they can't. Oh, they can hurt your feelings, sticks and stones and all that. But I promise you right now, Jesus can get on the inside where the root is, and he can uproot that thing and fill that thing with joy. This is why I'm against all that alcohol and everything else, because the little bit of benefit that it may give you, the little stress relief that you call it, I'm telling you right now, it says that the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I'm telling you right now that you don't need to drink. You don't need to pop pills, and you don't need to do none of that, because Jesus has an answer for every bit of that. He gave you a way of escape. It's right here. Paul's get told that, and he tells us, and I read it in your last scripture. Not only am I willing to be bound, I'm willing to die for this man's name, because this man's name is everything to me. You know what happens to Paul? That prophetic word is true. They go to Jerusalem right after that. Let me caution you. If it's in here, do it, even if it hurts. Even if it's a little scary sometimes. Even if it's a course change in your life. Understand that his ministry was about forgiveness, and then all of a sudden he realized he was to the Gentile and he was making great headway, and all of a sudden something happened in his ministry. He was told that it was about to shift, and he said it's okay because Jesus Christ is still Lord and I'm about it, and we all can say that with confidence, and then all of a sudden it shifts. And he goes from being Paul, the repentant one, the one bringing the message to Jesus, and he goes to that. Then all of a sudden, the rest of his life and ministry is about bondage, being bound in Christ. And he says it, and he makes it sound good, but it's about being in jail. Understand to me, there's no Corinthians, there's no Ephesians, there's no Galatians, there's none of these things, there's no Romans, there's none of this, there is therefore no condemnation in Christ Jesus. There's none of those scriptures. If Paul's not in a jail cell or in a house arrest somewhere in Rome, there's none of that if he doesn't get bound in Jerusalem. Listen to me, you feel like that things have turned worse, maybe your ministry, your life, you feel like things are frustrating right now, that Jesus isn't holding up his end of the bargain, that things, it can get confusing sometimes if you're focused on how you feel and what you see, and all of a sudden you're looking around. But Paul had to have enough faith, and he was persuaded that Jesus Christ is Lord, like it says in the Word. And if Jesus Christ is Lord, it doesn't matter if I got to go down the road and be bound, because I serve him at the pleasure of him. That means that I'll die for him. And that's where we got to get. You got to get persuaded. But you got to understand that your ministry is about to take off. I'm going to tell you something, not only for me and my family, but I felt this word strongly this morning. That you feel like that you are doing something good for God, and all of a sudden people show up. And whether it's a prophetic word or if it's other people, you find out that the church or whoever it is come against you. I promise you, if you ever had a church come against you, I know how you feel. And it'll be all right, I promise you. Look at me, I made it. All right, I made it out of it, you'll be all right. There's a church I can't even go to in Texas. I ain't even welcome. So it'll be all right, you'll make it, all right?
But all of a sudden, if you're willing to go into Jesus' name, if you're willing to go ahead and say, I am persuaded, and the power of that persuasion will allow you to be bound. Later on, it tells us, if you read after the scripture I read to you, read after, all of a sudden he goes to the high priest, and the high priest in front of everybody tells another minister to punch him in the mouth. It's in there, so you got to read your Bible to find it. Like another chapter later, whenever he gets there, the high priest, the head dog, the one we're supposed to lean on in the church, it'd be like Brother Don telling Brother Webb to punch me in the mouth. I said, like, he wouldn't do that. But that's what happened to him in front of everybody. But we got to go back. You got to go back to the reading where it says it's for Jesus. I am persuaded that, you know why? Because my faith is in him, because he's the only one to get me out. But from there, it goes further and farther. And all of a sudden now, he has to, see, you got to be punched in the mouth. And listen to me, people. Sometimes you got to be talked about in order to shift your ideas and your mindset in order to get back on Jesus. And sometimes people got to hurt your feelings in order to get shifted and get back on Jesus, because your persuasion isn't as strong as Jesus' ministry has for you next. Listen to me. He's not going to move you on to the next level if you're not persuaded about it. I'm not 100% persuaded I want to go to work tomorrow. But if I'm not, when I get up in the morning, I promise you, I'm going to call out. But something's going to happen to me from between here and then, and I'll get persuaded about them bills and about my family and about us wanting to eat. I'll get persuaded. Listen to me. It'll happen, and it's true. But we'll get persuaded about getting up and going to that job every day, but we'll miss church, and we'll miss out on things in God. Why? Because our persuasion needs a little help. I'm trying to tell you about the power of persuasion right now, that it will move you further, farther, faster. Paul gets down the road.
Open my Bible. In 21, I read to you, he said, I'm willing to go. In chapter 26. You got to go through them punching you in the mouth. And you got to go through people talking bad about you, lying on you. And you know Paul, and you can find in scripture where he tells testimony like at least three times. In Acts, it tells you, whoever wrote it tells you about the conversion of Paul. And then later on, Paul tells it again to the Jews. They ain't trying to hear it. Listen to me, sometimes the church don't care about it. And when I say church, I'm not talking about the church of the living God, the bride of Christ. I'm talking about your local assembly somewhere with some name on the outside. Pick one. It don't matter. They're all the same. If they're religious-minded and not Jesus-minded, they're all the same. Listen to me. They're all the same. I don't care what denomination it is. Doesn't matter. Nobody's exempt. If they're not about Jesus, they're religious. And if they're religious, they're about rules and they're about regulation and what they feel. And if that's the case, they're going to punch you in the mouth. They're going to talk bad about you. They're going to tear down what you're standing for. They're going to try to hurt you. But all of a sudden, Paul finds himself. And I'm coming to a close. Stand at your feet. Paul finds himself with Agrippa and Festus. Well, what does that mean? I got excited about it. Paul went from just being just an apostle of Jesus, just a guy that the Jews tolerated, just a guy in the church house. And listen to me. No, I know somebody's watching online. If you just feel like you've been tolerated in your ministry, like you don't fit in with the good club and you don't have the right suit and you don't have all the right pedigree and you're like me and you don't come from a good place and you got sin in your background and they don't want to give you a license and they don't want to help you out, I understand. I'm right there with you. But if you'll just stay committed and persuaded about Jesus Christ and go through what God has you to go through, there's a level of influence that's coming in your life.
Right.
All of a sudden, you'll get moved up. And maybe the church leader at the time, maybe Ananias, saw you as nobody but a speed bump in the road to what he wanted. And maybe that is the truth. And you know what he did? He had those people punch you in the mouth in front of everybody, Paul. But you know what? There's something about you that they can't stomp out. There's something that Jesus Christ had put on the inside of each and every one of us that the world, and I don't care who, what church it is, cannot stomp it out. That Jesus Christ is Lord. And if it's in you and you're persuaded, then all of a sudden your influence will graduate through pain of adversity most of the time. Oh, I know y'all wanted to just hit the altar and then walk out and have a pastor of a 500-person church. Hallelujah. It sounds good. It sounds good. It sounds fiction, but it sounds good too. But what will happen is when you're persuaded about Jesus Christ, that you'll show back up every time. And then the drug addict that they saw in you will no longer be seen.
Because you'll go down the road and yeah, maybe you'll go through some things. But the whole time you never hear Paul complain about it. He just always chalks it up that I'm a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm here, I'm a bondsman with Jesus Christ. That means that I'm killed all the day long because of Jesus Christ. Whatever happens to me, I'm persuaded that Jesus Christ is Lord. Because I had an experience one time and he was faithful every time. And because of that, all of a sudden he finds himself in the presence of people who really can move heaven and earth. And maybe Agrippa didn't, but he come close. Maybe your ministry doesn't feel like it's doing much right now, but you're going to be in rooms where people that are really going to be able to do things in life. I'm talking about Festus and Agrippa. I'm not talking about Ananias. I'm not talking about the local pastor. I'm talking about people who order governments and they move. I'm talking about nations and kings. I'm talking about presidents and senators. I'm talking about sitting in rooms where all of a sudden that your ministry and who you were supposed to be starts to come out, and you start to realize that Jesus didn't want you back there. You had a chance, you could have run. But because you were persuaded, the power of persuasion in Jesus Christ has now moved you on, and now you find yourself speaking about your testimony and how Jesus Christ moved mountains for you, and how you were even said that I voted. I saw Stephen and I voted. I held the coats and I voted against Christians. I was a murderer. It's in there. But because it's in there, all of a sudden, Paul said, you know what? I didn't let that stay in there. I'm persuaded that Jesus Christ, that nothing can stop the love of God. And because nothing can, I rooted it out because I know that Jesus doesn't want it. And I allow the Holy Ghost to do it for me. And now he's in the presence of a king and over a magistrate. And he's over, and all of a sudden, things start to happen. And he gets to go on to Rome. And you got to read all the epistles. But you don't get those if Paul decides that, you know what, I'm just not persuaded about this thing. Agabus said that there's going to be trouble and trials and tribulation coming down the road, and that they're going to bind me up. Then all of a sudden, I'm going to be locked up. Here I am. I thought I escaped the old life where I was awesome, and then I found out I was evil, and all of a sudden, God moved, and here I am, and I got an awesome testimony about being blind, and then an apostle touched me, and I got this great thing, and I'm telling everybody, and all of a sudden, now Gentiles, they're getting the Holy Ghost, and we're baptizing them in Jesus' name, and the world is great. I feel the anointing of my ministry. And all of a sudden, there's a binding that's coming. And the power of persuasion in Christ is the only thing that's going to get you past the trial that God is trying to elevate your ministry and who you are in life to where you're sitting amongst kings and princes. And all of a sudden, now you're being able to speak the word of God in the places that you've never, ever imagined. See, Paul never thought he was going that far. He just thought he was going down there to the Jews. And then it was the Gentiles. And he relegated himself to that. He said, that's awesome. It's going to be great. But then God had other plans. See, now his writings from jail and all the things that he is, his explanations of the gifts of the Spirit and all these other things, now there are not only staples in life, but we quote them. There's no, therefore, no condemnation in Christ Jesus. And all of a sudden we lean on those because somebody was persuaded enough to go down there and be bound. I don't know about you, but I'm persuaded this morning. I'm passionate about it. I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings, but it's not me. I'm just going to start walking around like this from now on. And maybe you won't hurt me or try to hurt me, but you can't. I've been bound to Christ, and I'm not leaving here until you. It's just like me and that man wrestling with the angel. I won't let you go till you touch me. I'm not willing to let go of this thing. I don't care if it puts me in shackles. I don't care if I got to go through some more heartache. If it's about Jesus, it's about Jesus, and that's enough for me. Because he's the one that set me free. He's the one that heals us. He's the one that saves us. He is God incarnate. Can I get an amen? She's about to start the music. The altar is over. If you feel like that, you need to up your persuasion today. If you feel like that, you know what? Maybe you ain't quite persuaded on everything. Or maybe you just need to read the word of God a little bit more. Just so you can be persuaded fully about what it says in there. If your heart's been pricked about something that God's speaking to you about, please.